Today I will be speaking in behalf of Sanko Tukoray because he had health issues. So I will be talking about developing scalable microservices with Node.js, Docker Cloud, and RabbitMQ. First of all, let me talk about myself, as always. So I am a Linux software architect at Tuşla currently. I'm a computer engineer from Sabancı University. I'm a musician. I play violin, drums, and keyboard a little bit. And I'm an open source contributor. I'm currently contributing on several bot frameworks at the moment because we all know it's a hype right now, developing bots. So here's my experiences. I am working at Tuşla for the past year. We are a trend call center solutions company. We are developing platforms that connects companies with consumers. Before that, I was working at Sinolive. Before that, Emnakshit. I started working at Startup Kitchen, actually. And before that, I was an intern at University of California, Santa Barbara, for over 2 or 3 months. And before that, I worked at InterRed and Prodeft on security-related solutions. These are the projects that I've contributed, and I'm still contributing right now. I don't know if you know BotKit, but it's a bot framework supported by Slack itself. It's currently have 10,000 stars at GitHub. And after working at BotKit, I realized some problems with the BotKit architecture itself. So I started developing my own, which is called SourceBot. The aim was to develop SourceBot is to write code once and deploy it to several platforms, including Slack, Facebook, Skype, using the same exact code. So I also contributed on coding, if you know coding. Coding is a development infrastructure management tool, which is a software, which is a company built in Go, Node.js, CoffeeScript. And I've written several tests of coding's KD UI framework. I've developed stand-up meetings for Slack project, which is free. You can download it on GitHub. And I've also contributed on Composer, the PHP library, several times. So let me tell you more about Tuşla. We are currently a small team of size of 8. There are 3 developers and 5 business-related people working at Tuşla. Right now we have several products. We have Tuşla mobile application and website, which uses the same exact code in different platforms. There are actually over 1 million active users monthly in both the mobile app and the website. And for the past 3 weeks, we are developing a new product, which is used by several companies at the moment, Tuşla WhatsApp client. The aim was to actually develop a solution to WhatsApp call center solutions. So, as you know, WhatsApp doesn't support business-related communication on WhatsApp, the platform itself. So, we started developing an application that uses WhatsApp infrastructure and connecting multiple agents to the same exact WhatsApp client. Right now, we are storing around 10,000 daily messages on MongoDB and using microservices daily on both the mobile application website part and the WhatsApp client part. So the main topic that we will be discussing today is to develop a scalable backend service that you can rely on and which costs less, because as you know, in Turkey and in both startup world, it's really important to keep your cost at minimum. So that's the main goal to translating to monolithic to microservices-based architecture in our perspective. So I have been working for startups for the last 3 years. I've worked at several companies. So these are the major things that I've really encountered and I believe that I should really focus on. So I wanted to share these things with you. There are several factors that that affects your software development patterns and software development process itself. So one thing you should consider is that you should be ready for a major change. All of your backend code should be flexible. It should help you translate. It should help you pivot to different products, let's say. So the second important thing is able to take actions quickly. You shouldn't while taking actions, you should know that your product should always be up. It shouldn't be down as long as it's like 10 seconds or a minute, maybe. So to evaluate the pivot as soon as possible is really important because you should know your customers well enough that what you should consider changing your product to their needs. Because without your customers, the application itself is useless, even though you did develop a really good architecture or a product itself. So the most important thing is actually to create a flexible architecture. What we mean by flexible architecture is this. You are going to change your product a lot. The needs of your customers will change a lot. And you should select a reliable database. You should select an important messaging queue library, a service. And you should use caches, etc. So in order to estimate the changes that you're going to do, you will do in the future, you have to create a flexible architecture. So there are several steps of development that I really care about, and I suggest you do the same thing too. The first step is understanding the needs of product. So a customer comes to you and says that, okay, we want a solution, let's say on WhatsApp, but we have a problem. First of all, identify the problem and how can we solve it. The problem is, let's say, WhatsApp doesn't offer to connect multiple agents at the same time, so we have a problem here. The second part is to choose the right architecture. So if you're going to use, first of all, you have to understand the architecture of microservices. You have to ask yourself the question, is microservices a solution for me? We will get back on it in a minute. The third part is database selection. Okay, you know how to do. You have information on, let's say, relational databases or non-relational databases. You have to ask yourself that what queries I will be performing, what queries should be done at most, and the fourth part is choosing the right messaging queue library, let's say RabbitMQ. And the fifth part is front-end library selection. I will not be focusing on selecting the right front-end library selection right now, but like the ability to choose between AngularJS or ReactJS is really important, as well as 90% of developers doesn't even recognize it. The amount of DOM manipulations and the amount of changes that you're going to do and creating a really fast UI application is really important, so choose your front-end library really well. Let me just give an example of this problem. When we were developing WhatsApp client web page, we thought that AngularJS is the right framework for us, but after a while, client of ours started getting more than 5,000 messages daily, and in order to render 5,000 messages on the same Chrome browser or same browser and doing it on cross-platform compatibility is really hard in AngularJS, so we wanted to use a library that offers a virtual DOM approach to this solution, so we change to React. Okay, let me tell you more about microservices. There's a small description. In short, the microservice architecture style is an approach to developing a single application as a suite of small services, each running in its own process and communicating with lightweight mechanisms, which is actually this. So you have you are going to write an backend service for an application. You have to compartmentalize each items. Let's say you have database insertion and updating, reading, etc. They're all the crude part. You have, let's say, an image upload service. And let's say you're using Redis to actually cache some things up and down. So like you have to split these items into different processes. So in database microservice, the most important thing is the user input and output. So it should rely on a reliable server that offers the best solution for I/O operations. But on let's say image upload microservice, you're going to use a lot of CPU because you're going to use FFmpeg, which really consumes a lot of CPU. So you're going to need a different machine for that. If you're going to, if you have to go to develop the most reliable backend service, so microservices is really important for that. So there are two most used architectures in terms of microservices. The first is monolithic. This is the actual architecture that you're all going to, you all did once when you started learning how to create a backend system. And also there is microservices. There are two different scalings. First of all, let me show you that. There are two different scalings, which is horizontal and vertical scaling. So if you're developing let's say monolithic application, so all of your business logic and the database collection and all of your socket connections, everything that you've written on the backend side is a one single big process, and it's called monolithic applications. So in terms of scaling, what you can do best is to actually upgrade your server, which is called vertical scaling. You first had a small system and you start getting more traffic, and you thought that, okay, I can scale it because I'm not using microservices. So you're going to pay a lot of money to actually scale and improve your server. So the other solution is microservices. There are several different servers, let's say for database operations, for image upload, let's say. So what you can do in microservices is you can scale it horizontally, you can create multiple HTTP servers, you can create multiple image upload microservices. And the best part of using horizontal scaling is this: if you're storing a lot of images but not getting a lot of HTTP requests, let's say, in some case, you will need horizontal scaling, and you will only scale the necessary items that you're going to scale. So there's the difference between horizontal and the vertical scaling. So the monolithic applications, let's say you started writing a Node.js application. Node.js, let's say we first connected our process to our database. Okay, so we're getting a lot of requests. And after that, we started introducing cache-based solutions, let's say Redis to store key-value pairs. And after that, okay, all of your code is going to connect both Redis, both, let's say, Elasticsearch, Mongo, and everything related to the business is going to be on the same exact code base, which is bad, and we will see it so forth. So in microservices, each microservice is going to connect to the service that it requires and it needs. So like, for database operations, the database microservice is going to connect Mongo or Postgre only, but the image upload microservice shouldn't connect to any database operations or Redis, so which will actually compartmentalize our every microservice. monolithic application is not agile. So a change done in your code base is going to restart the single process every time. So let's say you have an active development cycle, you're doing a lot of commits, you're changing a lot of code. If you push your code to production, it will restart the process again. And if it's using a lot of resources, it will boot slowly. But on microservices, you're pushing to every service that you change. So it will start faster because the requirements of the microservice process is less than the monolithic one. And as we told in the vertical scaling part, the monolithic process cannot scale independently. It should do vertical scaling. But on the microservices part, you can scale independently. So if you're getting a lot of socket connections, you can scale the socket connection process more than, let's say, HTTP or image upload microservice. And there is another approach which is really trend right now, which is called serverless. The serverless actually was offered by Amazon Lambda on top of API Gateway. So how serverless works is this. Actually, each function runs on different processes. So you don't really care about scaling. You don't really care about doing anything related to backend systems and the server-related part. So you don't need a system administrator to handle all of your load because Amazon Lambda does this for you. So each function, let's say you have a user read request, you have a user get request, update and read and create, let's say. So each function serves from a different process. And what really is really good in terms of Amazon in here is that Amazon doesn't charge you on idle time. So the amount of money you are going to give to Amazon will increase at the same rate that you are getting those requests, which is really important for startups. But it's another topic, serverless, because it's really new, and in even Amazon, it takes around 50 milliseconds more than the actual function runs. So it's not really production ready if you are if you really care about the response times of the servers. And actually, if you are using a cron job, let's say if you are going to use your process 24/7, the most important part is probably serverless isn't your solution for this because it only charges for non-idle time. So you're going to pay a lot of money for that cron job. So I don't really suggest using serverless for a backend system that requires a lot of checks and it requires to run on cron jobs, etc. So let's come to RabbitMQ. I don't know if you heard about RabbitMQ, but it's in this business for 6 or 7 years. RabbitMQ is used by a lot of companies worldwide, supported by many people around the community. What RabbitMQ does is this. It's a robust messaging for applications. So you have different processes, your microservices, but you want to handle them independently and you want to scale them independently without even thinking of the inconsistencies. So RabbitMQ is the solution for this. There are several keywords that you should actually think about while using RabbitMQ, which is a really tricky topic. The thing is there are two different items, items in RabbitMQ, which is exchange and queues. The ability to distinct exchange and queue is really hard, so I'm going to give a simple explanation about it. Let's say you are going to Apple Store, you walk into the store and you say that, okay, somebody comes to you and asks you, how can I help you? And you say that I have a problem with my Mac or iPhone, etc. And that person redirects you to the person that's in charge of Mac. So the person that greets you is an exchange. It redirects you to the queue that you should be going. So So in every request that you're getting, there is an exchange that redirects you to the queue that you should be going. So before the libraries, let me give you a brief example. So there is a publisher. Let's say it's the HTTP library that you're getting, because in every HTTP request, you're going to create an event. You're going to publish something. Let's say my publish event is create an image event. It's going to publish to an exchange, and an exchange is going to route it to a queue. So it says that there's different consumers, different image upload microservices that is going to consume specific events from the queue that it's connected to. So let's say it's image upload process. You started to get multiple image upload requests, and the consumer is going to consume every queue from there. Sorry. So this is how RabbitMQ actually works. You shouldn't think of it as a really hard topic, or it's really so like I can give you a lot of examples in terms of this, but the most important part is that you should be understanding the difference between an exchange and a queue. So actually what's really good about RabbitMQ is this: you can use different languages, different platforms, different cross platforms to understand, to work on these microservices. So like, as you know, not every language is the optimal language for the operation that you're making. So in socket connections, Erlang is the most used and the most efficient way, most efficient language to develop your, to connect to sockets. So like, in Node, there are several use cases that really offers the best solution for Node. So, MQP library actually offers different clients that you can use from different languages. So I can write my image upload microservice in, let's say, Go, and I can create my server in Node, and they're both using the same MQP client. So, that's the most important part that RabbitMQ offers. There's like Java, Node, Node, and libraries, and we're actually using microservice kits, which is offered by Sinolife. You can take a look at it also. That's the case. So we understand the difference between, we understand the messaging queue libraries, we know what a queue and an exchange is. So the most important part in selecting the architecture of a product you're getting is the database part. This is a really tricky part. You shouldn't select your database in terms of the knowledge of your members. Because not every database and every solution is the best solution for your needs. So there are two different database solutions, which is a relational one and a non-relational one. I know that you all heard about MySQL, PostgreSQL, or MongoDB, but while selecting a database in your product, you should consider different factors. So in relational, you have a structured data, there are tables, there are roles, which is really fast for several operations. So if you're going to get multiple roles from a database, you will need a relational one. But in non-relational one, you have an unstructured data. Let's say you have messages, you have, let's say you're storing transactions, you're storing non-relational schemas, non-relational items in your database. So the MongoDB or Neo4j is your solution. You have schemas instead of tables, you have documents instead of roles. Documents is actually a JSON object stored in MongoDB or Neo4j. So in non-relational part, it's better for horizontal scaling. And in terms of this, while selecting your database, you should actually focus on the benchmarks of the database that you're selecting. So like in single read, less is better actually. For the single read, MongoDB is better, but the Postgre takes around 250%. But in terms of, let's say, single write, MongoDB takes a lot of time, and PostgreSQL is the most efficient one. So let's go back to the first slide that I was talking about. Choosing the right database for your product is the most important part. So, so you're a startup, you start developing a product, but you don't know what to do because you don't know, you can't estimate the change that you're going to get in the future because your product is always going to change. So you have to use an optimal solution for this. So you're going to take the median of all of these results, which I actually offer. PostgreSQL is the most optimum solution in this case, even though others may suggest MySQL, but from my personal point of view, I suggest using PostgreSQL, even though I did develop a lot on MongoDB and MySQL in the past 3 or 4 years. Yeah, so we have selected our database, we have selected our messaging queue library, we can use whatever language we want while developing Dockers, while developing our microservices. So let's deploy it to production, because if you don't deploy it to production, then it doesn't mean anything at all. So there is an excellent solution called Docker. Docker is a software containerization platform. So every Docker instance run independently from each other. So there exists an isolation, and it's lightweight and simple. The most important part, because in startups, you don't want to hire a system administrator, you don't want to hire a database administrator, because we all know it's really hard to find a really good database administrator or a system administrator. So what Docker offers is, it offers a solution that works on multiple platforms, on Windows, Linux, and Mac. So that's the most important part of using Docker. I'm not going to get real deep into Docker because it's a whole new level, actually. So Docker also offers a different solution, which is called Docker Cloud. So Docker Cloud offers continuous development and continuous integration. So you can push your Git repository, and it can deploy in several minutes to your server. What you have to do is, what really makes Docker Cloud different from other solutions is this, actually. It offers solutions in terms of Amazon AWS. It offers Azure solutions, and actually it offers a daemon that you can deploy to any server you want. So right now we are using Scaleway. So we have been using Docker Cloud daemon to actually deploy it to our servers. So that's the best solution that I can think of in terms of a Docker deployment to Docker part. So right now we know Docker, we know RabbitMQ, we know what database we should be thinking of, and what messaging queue library we should be using. So this is an example architecture that I've found it on the internet, but it applies to our solution. So let's think of the service as a client that uses and consumes our backend systems. So a request comes, and your load balancer gets it. Load balancer is actually an Nginx or Apache solution, a web server solution, and it asks the service registry if there are multiple instances that serves the same purpose. So the service registry sends the data to different load processes, and in here actually you have the microservices. So in here there are three same horizontally scaled instances, which can help you a lot, actually. So this is an example. So let's do some questions and actually talk about how we can apply to our solution. So let's. I was actually in Stockholm 2 months ago. I had an interview with Spotify, and they asked me a question about the architecture of Spotify. So they asked me, and I want to ask you also. Feel free to ask questions and answer my questions because it's an interactive one. So you want to develop a Spotify-like service. How can we do it? So in terms of database, what do you think is the most suitable solution for a Spotify-like service? What do you think? Don't be shy. Yeah. MongoDB. So, are there any other guests? Yes. Don't feel shy. I won't bite. Okay. So, let's say MongoDB. MongoDB is a non-relational database, so it's the best suitable option for a non-relational solution. So, before answering the database solution, let's think of models. What schemas, what tables, let's say, you're going to need for a Spotify-like user service. Do you think of any models?
Yeah. You can have users and categories for music.
Yes.
Like music and other average of these tables for
yeah.
categories for followers.
So, like, what basically you have is this. Let me just tell it in a long way. You have users, you have albums, you have artists, you have songs, which are different items that should be stored in different tables because you don't want to have one single table or schema for every item that you're getting. So, in terms of models, okay, we have different models. So a user can listen to multiple songs, and you should store it. An artist can have multiple albums. An album can have multiple songs. So as you know, it's really relational. So let's say I want to get all of the songs offered by an artist that is in the same album, let's say. So you're going to, if it's a non-relational database, you're going to take a lot of time to actually populate data and go over to the same table again. Because in MongoDB, in every document that you have an object ID and a relation, you're going to take another, you're going to process and you're going to query every object ID for that. So non-relational database is not the most optimal solution for this if you're going to have a lot of users. So, in terms of messaging queue, yeah, we can use RabbitMQ. So, what other servers can we use? Do you think of any one? What? Yeah, Nginx, Apache. There's several solutions. I personally think as Nginx, because I'm not really that kind of I'm not really that kind of into tags and HTML-like syntax that Apache offers. So I would use Nginx server. So okay, let's think of the architecture and let's think of it as a whole. A user connects to the tag system. It sends a request. Okay, if the user is authenticated, okay, it returns me all of the songs. Let's say I've sent a request to get the songs that I've listened. So I'm getting all of the songs, I have a list of it, and I want to listen it. So how can I listen it? Do you think of a solution? Let's say, just think of, don't think of it as a client, but think of a backend system. So I should be storing songs in a different place rather than database stuff. Because of all of the input-output operations. So a CDN is required. if you don't know CDN, it's called Content Delivery Network, which offers different solutions from different continents. So if I'm living in Turkey, the closest CDN server to me is, let's say, Frankfurt. But if I'm connecting from United States, the CDN should be returned from the New York, let's say, because New York is closer to me, which takes less time in terms of milliseconds in there. So there is a room for optimization. So we all have a RabbitMQ. In every operation that RabbitMQ does, it loses like 30 or 40 milliseconds. So there are several operations going on. So I want to click on the play button, and I want to play it as soon as possible, because as we all know, we don't like waiting. So can you think of a solution that offers to listen, offers to actually speed up the play button and the response of it? Sorry? Yes. Okay, yeah. One solution is using a preload.
All the users can cache efficient, but they load both data.
Yes.
The first thing you should play, and then secondly, you are in cache.
Yeah. There are actually several solutions to it. You can pre-cache it. Can you think of a different solution for this problem?
I think the CDN is a solution for this problem.
But actually, in order to get the CDN link of a song that you're getting, you have to query database, you have to query, you have to send it to database microservice and to connect to CDN, etc. So, yeah, actually CDN is a solution. So what you're telling is the optimal solution is between them. So in order to play it as soon as possible, what Spotify like music services is doing is this actually. It estimates, it guesses what song you should be playing next, and it tries to find the next song. So while playing a song that you're playing right now, it actually caches the next 50 songs that it's statistically possible for you to play. So it only stores the fifth, like let's say the first 5 or 10 seconds of it, and after that, so you went back to play that song, let's say the cache song, there exists a 10-second part of the song that you're listening. So it's connecting the CDN document with the 5th second, and it's merging them at the same time that you're listening it. So
it's transcoding also.
What?
You'll be transcoding files.
Yes.
So it goes transcoding files with your file to.
Yes, like streaming. Yeah.
So like this is kind of preloaded.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah. So like while listening to it, it merges the two documents, two songs, and it offers you the best solution for speed, which is really important for services like this. So that's the case. If you have any questions, I will be really glad to. Yeah. All technologies have disadvantages. So what microservices doesn't really solve in terms of here is this. For every request that you're making, you're using a different service to actually transmit data from each other. And every service, even if it's 100% efficient and it's really well written, it takes time. So in every, let's say, in every message that you're sending to the queue, it actually takes 30 or 40 milliseconds. So like if you have, if you're getting a lot of messages, this problem can take time. So that's the actually the disadvantage of using, but it's really not, like I can't think of a really, really important example to not use a microservice, because most of the companies, they're all using microservices, which offers best scaling possibilities for a Service that's used a lot. Yeah.
Can you show us an example for a software build and think about the first microservice?
Actually, I don't have any code examples right now because I'm much more giving the information regarding the architecture of it because it's the most tricky part. But there are really great examples that you can get. I can give you some links afterwards. And if you have any problems with in terms of coding about it, you can always ask me. My email is yagiz@tush.la. You can get it from there, or yagiznizipte@gmail.com. You can send me an email from there, or you can add me from Twitter, or GitHub, or Facebook. Yeah.
Does WhatsApp use this microservice?
I don't know how how WhatsApp uses, but what I've read from different companies' solutions, they're all using microservices in terms of these operations. Any other questions? Anything about database?
So, for example, you said you use non-relational database. In which case, you need to think non-relational database. You use a relational database for
you want to give an example of a non-relational database example, right? Okay, so like if you have a relational structure, a relational data, you should be using relational databases, MySQL, PostgreSQL, SQL Server. But you have a non-relational database, let's give an example to it. The most optimum solution is to use the bold databases in your application. So it's called a hybrid database solution. You can use PostgreSQL, MySQL for relational data, and you can use Mongo for non-relational. So let's keep this. We have a really highly used application, and we should be storing logs. We should be storing, let's say, transactions. We should be storing non-relational and shouldn't be populated information in our database, so we can use MongoDB. So like, I want to store the IP addresses, the operations that the user is doing. We can store it on MongoDB. If we have, let's say, a user has a company has clients, etc., then we should use relational ones. Yeah.
Did you
use Telegram? Yeah, I've used
Telegram.
Actually, a product that is used a lot shouldn't and wouldn't use and actually won't use a monolithic application. Because in order to handle that kind of load on your servers, you have to actually buy a web server that's worth like 10 times the money that you should be using on a microservice. So Telegram and most of the companies that are getting a lot of traffic are using microservices. So like in our case, we have about 1 million users. So at the same time there exists around 500 users. And we have a WhatsApp client that gets 10,000 daily messages. We were using actually monolithic services, but monolithic services didn't actually help us on that. Okay. Yes.
This architecture recommends you have a database for each microservice.
So each microservice.
You have their own database. For example, you have a commerce site and order list and order microservices.
Yes.
Order list commands. You have a database for order list and you have a database for an order.
In terms of splitting your application to different microservices. Okay, let's talk about it.
Gracias.
future contributors. Future contributors.